Good afternoon, students. Today we will discuss the Renaissance period and the reign of Elizabeth, which is in your syllabus also in the first section. So the Renaissance, as we have already discussed, it is the 15th and the 16th centuries, which are the period of the European Renaissance, or we say the new birth. One of the three or the four great transforming movements of European history. And this impulse by which the medieval society of feudalism and chivalry was to be made over into what we call the modern world came first from Italy. And Italy, like the rest of the Roman Empire, had been overrun and conquered in the 15th century by the barbarian Teutonic tribes. But the devastation had been less complete there than in the more northern lands, even more perhaps than in France. The bulk of the people remained Latin in blood and in character also. Hence, it resulted that though the Middle Ages were in Italy a period of terrible political anarchy, yet the Italian culture recovered far more rapidly than that of the northern nations, whom the Italians continued down to the modern period to regard contemptuously. As we can say, they were still mere barbarians. And by the 14th and the 15th centuries, the Italian had become intellectually one of the keenest races whom the world has ever known. Though in morals, they were sinking to almost incredible corruptions. Already in the 14th century, Italy, the movement for a much fuller and a freer intellectual life had already begun. And we have seen that by Petrarch and Boccaccio, something of this spirit was transmitted to Chaucer. And in England, Chaucer was followed by the medievalizing 15th century, but in Italy, there was no such interruption. The Renaissance movement first received the definite direction from the rediscovery and the study of Greek literature, which clearly revealed the unbounded possibilities of life to men who had been groping dissatisfied within the narrow limits of the medieval thought. I would also like to tell you, students, that before Chaucer was dead, the study of Greek, almost forgotten in the Western Europe during the Middle Ages, had been renewed in Italy, and it received a still further impulse when, at the taking of Constantinople by the Turks in 1453, Greek scholars and their manuscripts were scattered all over to the West. It is very hard, students, to realize the meaning for the men of the 15th century of this revived knowledge of the life and the thought of the Greek race. The medieval church, at first merely from the brutal necessities of a period of anarchy, had for the most part frowned on the joy and the beauty of life, permitting a lot of pleasure, but as a thing half dangerous, and declaring that there was perfect safety only within the walls of the aesthetic church itself. And one thing more, I would like to say that the Renaissance, penetrating northward, passed first from the Italy to France. But as early as the middle of the 15th century, English students were frequenting the Italian universities. soon the study of Greek was introduced into England, and also first at Oxford, which was cultivated with good results. And when early in the 16th century, the great Dutch student and reformer Erasmus, unable through poverty to reach Italy, came to Oxford. He found there a group of accomplished scholars and gentlemen whose instruction and hospitable companionship aroused his unbounded delight. And one member of this group was a person known as John Collett. He became later the Dean of St. Paul's Cathedral in London, who was to bring new life into the secondary education of English boys by the establishment of St. Paul's Grammar School. Fine. So the whole of England was profoundly stirred by the Renaissance to a new and the most energetic life. But not least was this true of the court, where for a time literature was largely to the center. And jaisa maine aapko Tudor dynasty padhaya hai the first lecture mein. So since the old nobility had mostly perished in the wars, both Henry VII, the founder of the Tudor dynasty, aur uska jo beta tha Henry VIII, adopted the policy of replacing it with able and wealthy men of the middle class who would be strongly devoted to themselves. So क्या हुआ कि जो कोर्ट था वो बहुत ब्रिलियंट हो गया विद द क्राउडेड सर्किल ऑफ अनस्क्रूपलस बट अनयूजुअली एड्रॉइट स्टेट्समैन एंड अ सेंटर ऑफ लैविश एंटरटेनमेंट्स एंड डिस्प्ले. और अंडर दिस न्यू एरिस्टोक्रेसी रिजिडिटी ऑफ द फ्यूडल सिस्टम वॉज रिलैक्स्ड एंड लाइफ बिकेम ईजियर फॉर ऑल द डिपेंडेंट क्लासेस. इसके बाद एक पॉइंट आता है स्टूडेंट्स, जिसका नाम है द रिफॉर्मेशन. विद द रेनेसा यू हैव ऑल्सो टू अंडरस्टैंड द रिफॉर्मेशन.